So today we will have more algebra than geometry again. So we're going back to the foundations, and I will discuss the notion of triangulated categories, exact functors, and then also notion of generators, which was already somehow a little bit used. And then we'll talk about differential graded categories, DG categories. Right, so so if you have a chain map, recall that so if F is a chain map of complexes, wow, with this chalk I can stay twice as much, right? All right, so then we have the following diagram that we discussed to some degree. So we have then cone of F, the new complex, and it also maps to A shifted by 1. So this is called a standard triangle in homotopy category. And so basically what we want, what theory of triangulated category does, it axiomatizes this structure. So we want to axiomatize this structure. So here is a definition. So what is a, so yeah, maybe first the definition of a triangle. So when we have a so if T is a category with autoequivalence which we denote like shift translation goes to A of 1. So then a triangle is a sequence of morphisms. So it's something of the form A goes to B goes to C goes to A shifted by 1. So, and it doesn't look anything but a triangle, but I think the idea is that you kind of put this A, B, and C as vertices here. And then, so when you think about this morphism from C to A shifted by 1, you think of it as some kind of degree 1 morphism from C to A. So that's how it becomes a triangle. So now, so triangulated category, this is a category with a distinguished class of triangles. So T is, so it's an additive category. Equivalence A goes to A of 1, so which is usually called translation functor or shift functor. And so then we denote by, so then we have also the notion of A of n, where n is an integer, where we either iterate this one or its inverse. So we have this iterations. And plus, there should be a class of distinguished triangles. Which are also sometimes called exact triangles. And so this should satisfy the following axioms. So axioms. So the first axiom is rather silly. So it just says that x goes to x by identity goes to 0, goes to x of 1 is distinguished, is exact. I'll call them exact triangles. So also, yeah, there are several parts. So secondly, so maybe here I should have mentioned that there is a natural notion of a morphism between triangles. So it means the following, that you should have a diagram like this. So you have one triangle, you have another triangle. So there should be maps like this. And of course, this map should be the same as this one, but up to shift. So it's obtained by applying this autoequivalence to this map. And all the squares commute. So the second part of the axiom says that the class of exact triangles is stable under isomorphism of triangles. So triangle isomorphic to exact one is also exact. And part C is, no, there is no part C. So this is already next axiom, second axiom. Sorry. There is one more. Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure. Yeah, maybe not sure how they're split into ter 1, ter 2, but I think in ter 2, the main property is that any morphism can be included into a triangle. Can be completed to a triangle. Maybe it's still part of ter 1. That's what I cannot understand from my notes. Where is the beginning of ter 2 and where is the end of ter 1? An exact triangle. I think it varies, actually, and I've seen it different. So. Verdier was the creator of this, but maybe later writers had different splitting into axioms. So that's correct. Yes. So there exists x to y to z. So like this. Yeah. So like in homotopy category, you start with any morphism and then you construct the cone. So this part can be really understood. So yeah, I'll say later that the Z is kind of sometimes called the cone of F, and in some sense this is justified. So the second axiom is the following: that if you have an exact triangle, So if this map is exact, so if this triangle is exact, then you can create a new triangle by kind of shifting by one here. So you, there is kind of cyclic. So if you look in this picture, so you kind of you can just rotate it by 1/3 and so of the full circle. So this triangle is also distinguished, is also exact. But there is one nuance here that this is not f shifted by 1, but minus f shifted by 1. And this is justified by the by something we know from the homotopy category. So I think Nick considered this kind of thing in the homotopy category and showed that it's actually a homotopy equivalent. So this will be homotopy equivalent to the cone of this. Maybe this was an exercise, or maybe it was actually in the lecture, yeah. Right. So then the next axiom probably is the one that's used more often than anything else, at least maybe this is kind of also often used, but it's kind of not referred to explicitly. But this one is the most working axiom. It says that if you have a if you have a commutative square, and the rows are extended to exact triangles, so then there exists a middle arrow here, so that it becomes the morphism of triangles. So any commutative in words, we say that any commutative square extends to a morphism of exact triangles. And the last axiom about which it wasn't first clear whether it's independent from the others, but it seems that it is. So it's called octahedron axiom. So it's an analog of property. Before I state the axiom, let me state that it's kind of motivated by, so it's analog of the following property of abelian categories. So in abelian categories, if you have a sequence of subobjects, then you have an isomorphism. So then you have what you can view y modulo x, quotient of y by x, as a submodule and as a subobject in Z mod X, and you have isomorphism of quotients. So Z mod X modulo Y mod X is isomorphic to Z mod Y. So I think this must be taught in abstract algebra courses, like for abelian groups or whatever. But this is a kind of property of any abelian category. So now, yeah, of course, you can imagine that the same property will hold if you have, for example, a chain complex, and here you have a subcomplex and another subcomplex. So this is how it is really related to the corresponding axiom in homotopy, in derived categories. So we start with the following diagram. So given So this kind of mimics this data, but now in homotopy category or rather in derived category, it doesn't make sense to talk about embeddings. So they just become arbitrary maps. So we kind of want to view this, and at the same time we also want to view embedding from X to Z. So this is this map. So then we extend this to an exact triangle. And so the third object in the derived triangle, it's kind of analog of this quotient of y mod x. So let's call it, I don't know, my notation here is weird, so, but I copied it from somewhere else. So we can extend this to an exact triangle, we can extend this to an exact triangle. So this is still no problem. And then, right, so then the claim is that there exists, so given this, there exists an extension here and an extension here, so that here you will have x prime equal to x prime. So yeah, so the fact that you get the same thing here and here, this is precisely this isomorphism here, if you follow. So this is kind of y mod x, this is z mod x. So this is complicated quotient, and this is straight z mod y. Yeah, but there is one additional commutative square that kind of doesn't fit in here. Plus, there should be commutativity, so this map from y prime to x of 1, which we have here. So it should fit into x, y prime to x prime to y of 1. So that's this map here. And finally here, well, this is the original map. So a theorem is that, which I'm not going to prove. So a theorem, so if we consider a homotopy category of complexes over an abelian category, so with the usual twist shift functor and with the class of so exact triangles by definition here will be those isomorphic to the standard triangles. So they should be. So they should be isomorphic to the triangle of the form A goes to B goes to cone of this morphism. So is triangulated. So if you have time, you probably should try to do it yourself. Just check these axioms. It's not very hard, but also you can read them in Gilf and Manin. So let me give you some, so to get some feel for the axioms, let's prove something with these axioms. So there is an important property of exact triangles which follows from these axioms. So if x goes to y goes to z goes to x of 1 is exact triangle in triangulated category, then maybe before I state this, let me introduce the notation. So in triangulated category, we write hom n x y. So this is hom from x to y shifted by n. So this is by analogy with x notation. So if x and y are objects of abelian category, this would be just xn. But for objects of triangulate category, this also n can be negative. So you can be positive or negative. So then, right, so suppose you have an exact triangle, then for any test object A, you actually get long exact sequences of morphisms. Have long exact sequence of the following form, hom I x, sorry, hom I a to x goes to hom I a to y goes to hom I a to z. Then goes to hom I plus 1 a to x and so forth. And similarly, so we have actually two long exact sequences for homes from A and also for homes to A. And the second one will be home from, okay, let's put this here. So home from Z to A, home from Y to A, home from X to A, and here it would be home I minus 1 from X to A. Yeah, maybe before even proving this, another remark is that you can iterate this property through 2. Right, and so if you iterate it 3 times from the triangle x, y, z, x of 1, you'll get the shifted triangle. X of 1 goes to y of 1, goes to z of 1, goes to x of 2, and actually if you just faithfully follow the rules, so all the morphisms here will be shift of the morphisms, but with minus 1. But if they're all with minus 1, then actually it's isomorphic to the same triangle without minus 1. So actually you get that if the triangle is exact, then the shifted triangle is also exact. So by applying this 3 times and using the fact that triangle isomorphic to exact triangle is also exact. Okay, so now the morphisms here are clear, right? So the morphisms in each place, the morphism is induced by the map, by the corresponding map here. So this is morphisms from A to X shifted by I. This is A to Y shifted by I. So from X shifted by I to Y shifted by I, we have a morphism, and it gives us, induces a map here. But also, unlike the case with short exact sequences of complexes where we have to invent some boundary homomorphism, here we don't have to invent anything. So this morphism is still just induced by this map. So it's, in some sense, makes the boundary homomorphisms kind of more explicit. It shows that they're just induced by some maps between shifted objects. Right, so let's prove this proposition. So proof of proposition. Well, the first thing, in order to be a long exact sequence, at least we should have that the composition of 2 consecutive arrows is 0. So let's check this. So for this, it's enough to check that if you have an exact triangle, the composition of 2 consecutive maps there is 0. So if x to y to z is exact, so let's say this is f, this is g, then g composed with f is 0. So So that's the first thing we need to check. Right? This then we can apply it to all the kind of cyclic permutations of this triangle so that it will show that other compositions are also zero. So that will show that at least we get complexes, at least these exact long exact sequences. So at least we have the composition of two arrows is consecutive arrows is zero. Right, so how do we check this? So we need to use axiom this one, the extension axiom. So namely, you have a map from x to x, identity. And you have a map from x to y. Yeah, this is also identity. And you have a map from x to y, which is, which one do I want? F, yeah? Right, and then this is 0. So according to the first axiom, there is an exact triangle x to 0. So now by the third axiom, there should be a map here which makes this commutative, and therefore composition is 0. Okay, so this shows that we get complexes. So secondly, we need to show exactness. So check. It's enough to check that just exactness in one place, because we can, because of this property, because we can kind of rotate the triangle, it's enough to check exactness in one place. So we have to check that when we take home from A to, I'll just check the first one and the second one is similar. So we need to check that home from A to Y goes to, or X home to A to Y goes to home to A to Z is exact in the middle. So what does it mean? So we have our triangle, x goes to y, goes to z, goes to x shifted by 1. And now we need to check that if there is something here, there's some morphism u here, let's call this f and g, such that it goes to 0 here, then it comes from something here. So we have a map u from a to y such that this composition is 0. So let's now again make our favorite triangle with identity map of A here. So the fact that this composition is 0 gives us commutative diagram of this form. So A to Y to Z actually factors through 0. And now let's apply this extension axiom. But we kind of apply it with a shift. So we view, instead of this triangle, we view the triangle where it continues like this, right? And we so this morphism extends. We actually, it extends to morphism of exact triangles. So here we have A shifted by 1. Right, so there exists, so the axiom says that there exists a map like this, right, which makes everything commutative. And now you look at this, so this gives you a map with, from A to X, so an element here. And the commutativity of this diagram shows you that composition of this map with F is precisely U. Maybe you have to change the sign somewhere, but that's how it works. Okay, so corollary of this proposition is that in this axiom, in the third axiom, if we had a commutative square where both vertical arrows were isomorphisms, then the third one is also isomorphism. So if we have a morphism of exact triangles, where these guys are isomorphisms, so morphism of exact triangles, such that F and G are isomorphisms, then this morphism is also isomorphism. So it actually becomes an isomorphism of exact triangles. So how do we check this? So in order to check that some morphism in a category is an isomorphism by Yonet dilemma, it's enough to check that the corresponding morphism of representable functors is isomorphism. So it's enough to check. So we check that when we consider any A, the induced map from home AZ to home AZ prime is an isomorphism. But this morphism fits into long exact sequence obtained by applying home from A to the first exact triangle and to the second exact triangle. And we will have, of course, by the construction, we'll have morphisms of exact triangles. And so this will be isomorphism, this will be isomorphism, this will be isomorphism, and this will be isomorphism. So therefore, this map is also isomorphism. Is it called five lemma? No? Whatever. So something which you can easily check. So if these are isomorphisms, then the map on kernels here induces an isomorphism. The map on images here induces an isomorphism. So this is kind of fit into short exact triple where this maps to isomorphic and this map isomorphically. Anyway, so this is well known. So we get that this map from home AZ to home AZ prime is an isomorphism. So therefore, the original map was an isomorphism. So this corollary, in particular, says that, remember, any morphism can be included by the first axiom into an exact triangle. And so the third term of this triangle is determined up to an isomorphism. So it's kind of important to observe that in this axiom, we do not require that it's any uniqueness. So it can become, so in principle, when we have this extension to the third, to an exact triangle, so we could have a different extension. Right, so it doesn't say anywhere that it's unique. But the corollary, so if we apply axiom tier three, so it tells us that there is actually a morphism of triangles here. And what we just proved, corollary, shows that, in fact, it's going to be an isomorphism. So whenever you, so this third object up to isomorphism is determined uniquely by this morphism F. So we can kind of say that, informally, I would say that C is a cone of F. But however, a subtlety here is that this construction is not functorial. So if we have, so this isomorphism is not unique, but this isomorphism in general is not unique. So namely, if you, yeah, so you cannot make this into a functor from the category of arrows into the original category. And that's one of the things that's considered to be problematic with these axioms. But there it is. So there is, however, an exercise which shows that sometimes this extension to morphism of triangles is unique. So if you have, so suppose you have morphism between two exact triangles. Let me look at the exercise. Yeah, it's exercise one. So you have this commutative diagram, and you're looking for the extension of this to a morphism of exact triangles. And so the claim is that if home minus 1 from A to C prime is 0, okay, so this is really, so if you think by definition, this is home from A to C prime shifted by minus 1, right? So if this one is 0, then this arrow is unique. So then extension is unique. This extension is unique. So there are some kind of limited situations where you can still make cone into a functorial construction within the axiomatics of triangulated category. Yeah, another exercise which is just using these axioms and these properties to prove that if you have, you can easily check that the following is always an exact triangle. So if you have A goes to A, maybe I'll state the another. So another exercise is that if you have an exact triangle where this is 0, so then in fact there is a splitting. Then C is actually isomorphic to F1 plus B. So then this map from B to C admits a retraction from C to B. Okay, so. Right, so I stated the theorem that the homotopy category is triangulated, but we actually want not so much homotopy category, but derived category. And recall that derived category is obtained from homotopy category by localization. So we have to localize by the, have to invert quasi-isomorphisms. So there is a general formalism. So you suppose you start with triangulated category and you want to localize it, how to make sure that the localization is still triangulated. So there is a compatibility. So given a triangulated category, and the localizing class of morphisms, so we can ask for compatibility for the following. So we can say that this is definition. So we say that S is compatible with triangulated structure. Triangulated structure. If, first of all, it's closed under shifts, under translation. And secondly, in the third axiom, so in this extension axiom, so if we have if we have a morphism of if we have this commutative square where both vertical arrows are in S, so let's see, let's call them S1 and S2. So if S1 and S2 are in the localizing class S, then the third morphism here, which makes it a morphism of triangles, is also can be chosen in S. So in I think in the category of in the homotopy category, remember our class S is the class of quasi-isomorphisms. So this property is going to be satisfied automatically. So there it will hold for any extension. So if you take if you have a morphism of exact triangles in homotopy category, So quasi-isomorphisms is localizing class compatible with triangulated structure. So you just have to look at the at long exact sequence of cohomologies. So the property of being a quasi-isomorphism, this is that for every cohomology, so the induced map on cohomology is isomorphism. But the induced map on cohomology is going to fit into morphism of long exact sequence of cohomology. And so because here and here, these guys induce isomorphism on cohomology, by the same, by the five lemma, you get that this will also induce isomorphism on cohomology. And so there is a very easy formal check that kind of formal check that that if S is compatible with triangulated structure, then on the localized category you get a triangulated structure. But you have to say what are the triangles, so they will be just images of exact triangles under the map from, under the functor from T. Then T S inverse is triangulated, kind of has induced triangulated structure. So what is this induced triangulated structure? So we have, we just take triangles which are isomorphic to, so exact triangles are those isomorphic in this localized category to the exact triangles in T. So there is a natural functor from T to the localized category. So we just take all exact triangles in T and take all of those isomorphic to them in the localization. So then it's a formal check, which I will skip, to show that in this way you get a triangulated structure. And so from this, we apply this to quasi-isomorphisms in homotopy category. And we get a triangulated structure on derived category. So from this, we get triangulated structure on derived category. So, and by definition, so a triangle in derived category is exact. So exact triangle. So this will be, it should be isomorphic. So those which are isomorphic to the standard, to the standard triangles, A goes to B. So we should have actual chain map here, and then cone of F. OK, so now there is the following nice interpretation of this. So in fact, it turns out that there is a different way to think about exact triangles. In fact, they're very, very closely related to short exact sequences of complexes. So the claim is that any exact short exact sequence of complexes A0 extends, well, canonically to an exact triangle. Triangle in derived category. In derived category. So what happens is that there is some preferred map from C to A shifted by 1. So in derived category. So in principle, if you if you just know that it extends to an exact triangle, maybe there is more than one map that extends it to an exact triangle. But here there is a preferred map. So there is a canonical construction of this map from C to A shifted by 1, which makes this into an exact triangle. And furthermore, every exact triangle in derived category is obtained in this way. So in this way, we get all exact triangles up to isomorphism, yeah, in D of A up to isomorphism. So how do we do this? It's actually, again, a straightforward observation. So you have this short exact sequence of complexes. So we can take this chain map F, and we can consider the corresponding cone. So this one we know is exact triangle. So actually, we're going to construct isomorphism between, well, we kind of need to show that somehow this map is isomorphic to this map in derived category. So namely, there is a canonical map this way, right? So if you remember, there is a canonical chain map this way. So what is the ith term of the cone? So cone F I term, this is going to be BI plus AI plus 1. And so we just map it to, so let's call this G. So we just map it to C by sending this to 0 and mapping BI to CI using the morphism G. And the fact that it's a chain map is easy to check. It will use the fact that the composition of G and F is 0. So there, if you remember, in the cone, there is a the differential, so will be you use differential on B, use differential on A, plus the, you use F. But so the fact that G kills F shows you that this actually is going to be a chain map. Okay, so then the claim is that this is actually a quasi-isomorphism. Well, this is because it's actually easy to see. So you have to use you use the following kind of functoriality of cone in the homotopy category, or just in the category of complexes. So you have a consider the identity map from A to A. Then from this arrow we have a map into this arrow. A goes to B, where this is just embedding by F. This is identity. So therefore, and actually this is a long exact sequence. Yeah, so anyway, so this is going to be, here we take cone of identity. Here we have cone of F. So this is a commutative square. So therefore, in fact, you have a chain map from cone of identity and cone of F. And it's easy to see that because this was an embedding, this is going to be an embedding of a subcomplex, and the quotient complex is going to be C. So, and this will be our map Q. So, in fact, you easily check that there is this exact short exact sequence of complexes, which includes Q, and this is an acyclic complex because it's a cone of identity. So now, using the long exact sequence of cohomology, you see that Q induces isomorphism on cohomology because its kernel is acyclic. And the converse is also, well, the converse is easiest. It's kind of standard construction that if you you can make this standard, so the standard guy AB goes to cone F. You can make it into, yeah, by the way, sorry. So still in this picture, so you may notice what is this map in derived category from C to A. So it's obtained by inverting this Q and then using the canonical map from cone of F to A shifted by 1. So that's the preferred map from C to A shifted by 1. So, right, so, and to see that every cone, so that every exact triangle is isomorphic to the one coming from exact sequence, you just have to kind of fiddle a little bit with the standard exact triangle. So you have to enlarge B so that it's still quasi-isomorphic to B, but so that this will form an exact short exact sequence. So you can so this is done by using something called the cylinder of F. Yes. Yes, but how do you see that rotation of something isomorphic coming from exact triple? Short exact triple is, again, comes from short exact triple that I can see. Yeah, so actually, I think you can use this one. So what is this cylinder? So this is by definition, you take cone of the map from cone of F to A shifted by 1, and then shift the whole thing by minus 1. So basically, cone has something like a object of, so it'll be terms of B plus terms of A. This one will have terms of B plus terms of A plus terms of A shifted by 1. So it will kind of, it will be B up to a cone of identity on A. So it will be quasi-isomorphic to, so there is a canonical isomorphism between these guys in homotopy category. And so, and this is an exact sequence. This is a short exact sequence. In fact, it's split short exact sequence. So in every term, it splits. Okay, so that's the relation between short exact sequences and triangles. So they are up to isomorphism in derived category. They're almost the same thing. Now, the connection with what we did before is the following, that actually all the functors we considered for derived category, they respect the structure. They respect triangulated structure. And this we kind of already used implicitly. Maybe we kind of used the corresponding long exact sequences of cohomology. So, so definition, if you have two triangulated categories, so an additive functor is called exact. So exact functor means that it's additive and it sends, it has to commute. So this is actually data. It has to commute with the shifts between triangulated categories. So this should be explicit. This is actually part, this is unfortunately data. So you have to f of A shifted by 1, isomorphism with f of A, all of this shifted by 1. So this should be functorial isomorphisms. And it sends, and f of of exact triangle is exact. So because it commutes with the shift, it makes sense. So f of a triangle can be made into a triangle. So you use this to, right? So when you have A goes to f of A, goes to f of B, goes to f of C, goes to f of A of 1. So you identify this with f of A shifted by 1. So this can be viewed then as a triangle. And as a triangle, it should be exact in the second category. So the claim is that derived functors are exact. So say if you have a left exact functor between abelian categories, and you have, say you use injective resolutions, so right. So then when you have a complex, the derived functor will send this complex to f applied to the injective resolution of it, right? So if it's bounded below, so there is a quasi-isomorphism with some injective complex bounded below. And so now what you can, so basically the fact that it's exact, the corresponding derived functor is exact, it boils down to the fact that, what we do is we just kind of take F and restrict it to the homotopy category of injective complexes, complex of injective objects. And for homotopy category, the exact triangles, they're just standard triangles, right? And so when we apply F to the standard triangle, we again get a standard triangle because the construction of cone, of course, it survives this. So it commutes with F because F just because F is additive. So right, so F of cone of F is equal to cone of. So this is true for any additive functor. So therefore, all the Yeah, so the point is that somehow you use to, so the trick here is that to maybe that shows the usefulness of this connection between standard triangles and short exact sequences. So you you show exactness on injective resolutions, and it's kind of trivial because of this. But then, because we know that short exact sequences correspond isomorphic to exact triangles, we get that if you start with a short exact sequence in A1 and you apply derived functors to them, then you get actually an exact triangle. So this gives you, in particular, long exact sequences between derived, high derived functors. So it's kind of what we typically use in calculations. Right, so therefore, so all Fourier Mockai transforms are exact functors because they're defined as compositions of various derived functors. So an exercise is that if you have left, so if you have a functor between triangulated categories which is exact, then left to right adjoint to it is also exact. Yes, I am stopping now, yeah. Yeah, one maybe kind of thing you might be wondering, so when we consider these derived functors, we start with either left exact functor between abelian categories or right exact functor between abelian categories. And then on derived level, we get the functor which we just call exact. So what happened with this left and right, you may ask. So this actually is, so somehow it, to recover what this what it came from, you need sort of additional structure in derived category which remembers this abelian category sitting inside derived category. This is actually important structure, which is called the T structure, but we're not going to discuss it there. So basically, when you just have triangulated category, there is no notion of left exact or right exact. There is just notion of exact functor, period. But if you have a derived category with additional structure, with some abelian category sitting in it, then you can see how your functor behaves with respect to this abelian category, and then you will recover this left and right thing. All right, so let's now stop and do some exercises. So let's start passing this around. There we go. Go backwards.